What's up, YouTube? So before we get started with this video on First Take, we're going to be talking about how some of the 49er players were noticeably angry at Kyle Shanahan's play calling during the Super Bowl. So let's see what they have to say about that.
How do you view him after this loss?
I view him as the modern day version of Pete Carroll. Allow me to explain. Pete Carroll is a highly respected coach. Mm-hmm. The difference between him and Shanahan is that he's a champion.
Exactly, he's a champion, and that's a huge distinguishing factor.
But I want everybody to understand where I'm going with this. And this is something you need to know, because I've reported this on several occasions. I don't give a damn how much the Legion of Boom and everybody associated with them denied this. One day a book will come out and they will admit what I know, because I'm not saying it. I was told it, and I totally believe it. When Pete Carroll elected to have Russell Wilson throw that football, instead of giving it to Marshawn Lynch at the half-yard line, after Marshawn Lynch had rushed for 4.5 yards on a previous play and was just playing lights out in that second half against the New England Patriots in that Super Bowl, it deflated the Seahawks in such a fashion that they were never the same.
Yeah, because I think with that play, there was a lot of things going on. There's a lot of conspiracy theories, if you will, about why Beast Mode wasn't able to run the rock at the 1 yard line. So let's continue.
Because they knew the opportunity was there. You got no business blowing it. And something other than just playing pure football compromised your mode of thinking. When I saw those guys last night on those sidelines for the San Francisco 49ers, that's what I saw. I saw them looking at a coach. You know how you got the coach that never played? You know what I'm saying? But he's brilliant, and you respect him when you win him. But when you lose him, particularly when you go away from what worked, now suddenly the brothers step up on you, and they feel different. If you remember, you know one of the key moments in yesterday's game, real quick, y'all? For Kansas City, it was when Tyrann Mathieu was on the sideline going off. Called them words that can't be repeated over FCC airwaves and like, what we doing? And from that moment, Kansas City went out and stopped, made San Francisco pump for the first time and stopped them on those two possessions. He questioned their manner because at some point in time, it ain't about the coaching. It ain't about the plays they call or whatever. It's about us. And yesterday, Kyle Shanahan, you could see it in the eyes of numerous players. They were like, you got to be kidding me. What we doing here? How we go away from what we do. They didn't beat us with us being us. We had to listen and defer to this dude who ain't never been on the field. We had to defer to him and what he got us doing. And this dude is coaching scared and went away from everything that we are. Kyle Shanahan has had an excellent year, and he's proven to be pretty much a damn brilliant coach offensive mind.
I can agree with that.
But I don't give a damn how brilliant you are. The championship, the fourth quarter of a championship, in two occasions, you have been outscored 40-0, not including the 6 points in overtime, 40-0 with 7 possessions and not one single point.
So I don't necessarily think it's because the players are mad at Kyle Shanahan because he never played, so he doesn't really know what he's doing. I don't think that's – I think that could be a small part of why they were looking at him the way they were. Because, I mean, he got them to the Super Bowl. He's at the Super Bowl. He's been to the Super Bowl before. Of course, he choked. But, you know, as far as being a player, he knows what he's doing because he's at the big show. So I think what the players are mad at is what Stephen A. Smith was saying. He's like, look, why are we passing the ball when you know we don't have the most amount of confidence in Jimmy Garoppolo to be throwing the ball? And our bread and butter has been running the rock this whole time. So why are we getting away from that? And you can gradually see the momentum going from the 49ers all the way over to the Kansas City Chiefs, especially when Patrick Mahomes starts putting in work. So I think that's why the 49ers players were, you know, looking at him the way they were, because they know and they can feel that, you know, why are we getting away from what we're supposed to be doing and what was working? So, and we're up by 10 with, you know, 12 minutes left in the fourth quarter. All we have to do is run the rock. That's just smart football. You didn't have to be a player for that. So let's continue.
Philosophically, we have some overlap here, but I disagree with you about something important.
Sure.
Molly's been saying it all day. Scared money.
Don't make no money.
Scared money don't make money. I'm not worried about his performance in the second half to the extent you two are. I like the fact that he knew doing what he was doing, he could be, you know, second guessed the next day if it doesn't work. I like coaches who aren't worried about the negative outcome. Andy Reid went for it on fourth down. You know, time was, if you did that, oh, see, that's why you kicked the field goal. He's not worried about that. Scared money don't make money. I'm not worried about what they did in the second half. If Garoppolo hits Sanders on that pass, he got behind the defense, they win. It's an amazing play call, amazing by Jimmy G. They win the Super Bowl. He just missed. He missed with Kittle. Well, he should have known that. Now you got to have faith in your quarterback. That's not what gets me. But I'm talking about in the first half. You know, don't use your timeout. Settle for the field goal. Those kind of things. Because don't forget, in the first go-round, as the offensive coordinator for the Falcons, you know, he's also second-guessed left and right. That's the bottom line. So he gets scared of the negative outcome because he knows what's coming and as a result doesn't give his team the best chance to win. For that, he deserves blame. On the other hand, there's his team in the Super Bowl. There's his team in a one, you know, with a lead in the Super Bowl. So you got to give him some credit, too. In the end, they didn't win it because his team didn't perform. He does deserve criticism, not as much as you're giving him.
He should be.
So, again, I would say that, you know, I don't think it's because the players weren't looking at him because he was a player and doesn't know. Like Max said, no, he got them to the Super Bowl. He's been to the Super Bowl before. They were 13-3, so they had an excellent record. I think it's just, and I don't think he was playing scared. I think he might have been playing a little bit too safe. He's playing way too safe, and you can see it manifest itself in the first, at the end of the first half. You know, with, you know, him not trying to get down and get at least, you know, a field goal or get more points on the board. They just opted to go in 10-10 at the half. And it just doesn't make sense that he would do this. The defense was firing on all cylinders. So what the defense had, two picks off Patrick Mahomes in the second half. They caused three fumbles. They had, what, 4.5 to 5 sacks on Patrick Mahomes. And in the first quarter or the first half, when Jimmy Garoppolo threw an interception, the defense came through and they held Patrick Mahomes and Kansas City Chiefs to only 3 points. So defense was definitely balling. You could trust them. And the run game was going just fine. They were up by 10 points with 12 minutes left in the fourth quarter. Run the rock. There's no reason to pass. No reason whatsoever. So I don't think he was playing scared. I think he might have been playing a little bit too safe. But, you know, there was just no reason for him to do what he did. It's just bad play calling. Bad play calling. So, let's continue.
Dude has a really good offensive mind that can't win the big game. Same conversation we was having about Andy Reid before this game. If y'all remember, we talked about Andy Reid not winning the big ones, mismanaging clocks. Was he a Hall of Famer or not? Did he need this Super Bowl to solidify himself as one of the greatest coaches of all time? Because what we judge you on is, look, when you get to championships,
yeah,
everything before that becomes null and void. Mm-hmm. When you have a chance to win it. When we talk about sports, there are two seasons for a reason. And we are going to remember you by what you do when the chips are on the line. Yeah, it'll be great for somebody to say, you know what? Guess what? Bill Belichick could still be a great coach, but without 6 Super Bowls, we wouldn't say he was the greatest coach ever. We wouldn't. They have guys with great winning percentages and all of that. But
Marty
Bill Belichick,
Schottenheimer.
Yeah, absolutely. Bill.
Okay, so Max and Marcus Spears, let's use your same logic. You wouldn't say Bill Belichick the best head coach ever if he didn't have those 6 rings. Well, then on the same flip side, you can't say that Patrick Mahomes is the best quarterback to do it right now when he only has 1 ring. This is especially going to Max. So you can't agree with him that said, yeah, Bill Belichick would be considered the best head coach if he had 6 rings. But then on the same breath, you go and say, well, Patrick Mahomes is the best quarterback to do it when he's only won 1 Super Bowl. He got Super Bowl MVP, which is excellent. He was MVP last year, but you got to have longevity. That's the final steps in being able to be the best to ever do it. Like I said, there's levels to this. There's levels. And Patrick Mahomes is close to the level of you need to have longevity. You can't just win a Super Bowl or two and then not do good for 10 years and then be considered the best. You have to have longevity like what Tom Brady has. So I don't mean to get off track, but let's continue.
Belichick is known as the greatest because he's won 6 of the 9 he's been to. MJ, known as the greatest because he won 6 of 6. All of these things. So we are judging Kyle Shanahan based on where Kyle Shanahan ended up. And where he ended up was two times in the Super Bowl, being a fearful head coach to put your foot on somebody's neck and go win the game. That's, well, that is what he ended up
as. And here's what I'm saying. It's more indictable in a sport like football. If it's baseball, it's tolerable, the analytics portion of it all, the numbers game, etc. Basketball to a lesser degree or what have you. But when you come to a game as physical as football, Max is almost, again, I usually leave the boxing analogies to you, but I will tell you, it's like a trainer that knows you got our nuclear right hand. It's like Deontay Wilder's trainer telling him, you know what, just jab and stay away. Really?
What?
Is it what? What? That's what Kyle Shanahan did. And I'm like, when you come, again, I ask everybody, go to the cameras.
But is he coaching scared in the second half if he's throwing the ball? You want him to run.
I'm saying that I want him to run the football.
That's what I'm kind of thinking, too. I don't think he was coaching scared. I think he might have been playing it safe. And like I said, you really see that in the first half, at the end of the first half. But, you know, when it was, what, fourth quarter with 12 minutes left and he starts passing, that's not necessarily being scared. That's just bad play calling. I mean, that's just bad football. It doesn't matter if you played football before. It doesn't matter if anything. Just smart football would be, if you're up by 10 with 12 minutes left in the fourth quarter, you run the rock so you can kill with the clock. And at the same time, you know, Jimmy Garoppolo is guilty because you have to at least come through. You have to at least, you know, convert a first down to keep the clock running. At least get your team in field goal range so you can put some type of points up on the board to help supplement that 10-point lead you have with 12 minutes left in the fourth quarter. But they weren't able to do it. But again, like I said, I don't necessarily think he was playing scared. I think he was playing kind of a little bit too safe, especially in the first half. But, you know, throwing a ball, there's just no excuse for that. That's playing dangerous, as a matter of fact. That's being kind of risky, right? That's risky behavior right there, throwing a rock when you're up by 10. And there's no reason for him to be scared or to be worried when he has a 10-point lead. So I still don't understand why would he decide to start throwing the rock at that point in time. So I don't know. Let's continue.
I'm wanting him to run the football because you went away from your strength. And not
that's
only that,
not coaching scared.
Not that
scared,
you yeah. wanted, you wanted, you went away from what your boys wanted to do. You said what they know worked.